7 steps on how you can date men properly so that you don't get blamed. Number one, we have mindset. You have to make sure that when you're going out on these dates, that you bring the right mindset, because the wrong mindset will defeat the whole purpose of why you're there. Because obviously you're there to try to build a serious long-term relationship with someone that you plan to spend the rest of your life with. Now, obviously you're not going to bat 100% at the plate, meaning that every guy you go on a date with is not going to end up being your husband. But the goal is to efficiently and quickly find the guy that's going to be your husband and not waste any more of your time doing anything else other than finding your husband, which is why you're here, right? And so you want to make sure when you're going on these dates that you're bringing the right mindset to the date so that you can extract what you need from the date, which is why it's very important we're all here and paying attention at this beginning part, because it's going to crystallize everything else that we talk about, right? It's so important that you're paying attention, and it's so important that you're understanding of why you're on this date and the information you're trying to extract from this date. Because if you're not aware of what you're trying to extract from this date, you're going to be on this date aimless, not knowing what to talk about, not knowing why you're there, not knowing what questions to ask. You're not even going to know the reason that you're on the date, and it's going to be useless to you because you're going to leave the date, right? Not knowing if you're any closer to where you want to be or if you're farther away from that. And from that sense, it's just a waste of your time if you're not sure if you're moving closer towards something or farther away from something, right? You have to be moving forward in some direction, right? Or else you'll be stringing yourself along. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. So it's very important that you bring in the mindset that I want to learn more about you. I want to learn as much as humanly possible about you through the words that you say, through the actions that you show me, right? And just through a whole understanding of you as a human being, I need to learn as much as I possibly can about you in order to make a decision. Are you going to be someone that's going to be a suitable partner for me in the future and for the rest of my life? Or are you not? Because if you're not, then my time here is done. If you are, there's more learning and more exploring I have to do to ensure that. That's the only two ways you should be thinking. But you have to approach it with that mindset. I need to extract information so that I can make the best possible decision. And like I said, the information isn't just his words. It isn't just his actions. It isn't just what you see him doing and how he acts and how he responds to things and all that stuff. It's all of that, right? It's not just one of those things. Okay, so you need to come in with that mindset so that you can get the right result out of these dates. Because like we said before, you don't want to be on these dates wasting your time, okay? You don't want to be wasting your time on people who are not here or with you for the long haul or are not invested in the same thing that you're invested in, okay? I'm sure you're here because you're tired of giving away your Squirtle and not getting anything in return. You wouldn't be here if it wasn't the case. Okay, so we want to prevent that from happening, which means when you go into these dates, you have to have a concentrated effort focused on extracting the result that you want, which is a decision. Are you the guy I'm going to spend the rest of my life with or not? It's only one of those two. Okay, right? For example, this is why mindset is so important. And this is how it plays a role. For example, let's say a guy goes over to your place, or you go over to a guy's place, right? And as soon as you go over there, he's like, oh yeah, well, we're just going to hang out. We're just going to chill. We're just going to have a good time. You go over there, he turns on Netflix, and he immediately starts talking to you about SEX and other SEX-sual topics. You understand what I mean, right? And everything that comes out of his mouth seems to be related to SEX one way or another, right? He starts feeling up on you. You realize you're not really even there for the movie. You're really there to be his personal, pencil shaver. Okay? That's what you're really there for. And it's very clear to you what his mindset was going into spending this time with you, this date, whatever it may be, right? By how he's acting or the actions that he's showing you, right? So mindset plays a very big role in what you will get out of a situation, right? Because it also plays a role in your approach to the situation. That's why we have number two, which is the approach. And the approach is very related to the mindset, of course, because the right mindset will lead you to have the right approach on the date. You'll be enthusiastic and excited to get to know him, and he'll mirror you in the way he responds to you. This is if he's interested in you. So it's very important, right, that your mindset is in the right place so that your approach can be in the right place. The right approach is coming to the date with enthusiasm, coming to the date excited to get to know him and learn more about him, because that energy that you'll bring, right, that energy that you'll bring, that enthusiasm that you'll bring, that excitement that you'll bring to the date because you want to get to know more about him, he will naturally mirror that excitement. Whether it's real or not, whether it's fake or not, doesn't really matter at the beginning, because you're just trying to extract the truth and you're just trying to extract information. So the more excited he is to share with you because you want to learn about him, the better it is for you anyways, because it gets him in the flow of talking. It's the same aspect as building rapport, right? When I've given you guys this example many times in the police station, right? The criminal comes to the police station and the police officer wants to talk to the criminal, right? Because there was a murder on 79th Street. How come the police officer doesn't just ask the criminal as soon as he sits down in the police station, hey, did you commit that crime, that murder on 79th Street with the 9mm at 3:45 p.m.? How come that's not the whole extent of the interrogation and then that's it? Because that's the only information the police officer is really trying to extract from the criminal. But the police officer still sits down with the criminal, asks him a bunch of questions about his life, where he's been, what his relationships are like, what his friendships are like, how his work life is, all this stuff around the truth that the police officer is trying to extract, right? Because the way human beings work is when you build rapport with them, when you make them feel comfortable around you, right? When you do the job of, you know, laying the groundwork so that someone can feel comfortable enough to tell you the truth or tell you things about them, you will eventually get the truth. But it is on you to do or to go about the interview with the right approach so that you can extract what you want from the situation, okay? Because it is 100% possible to extract whatever truth you want from the man or the situation, the man in this case, because you're dating the man. But if you're not having the right approach to the situation, right? If you don't have the right mindset going into it, you won't be able to extract whatever it is that you want from the situation. And that only serves to your detriment, right? This is another example that I'll give you to you guys. For example, right? If I was asking you to borrow your car, right? And I gave you, there's two ways of me asking you to borrow your car, right? Let's say way number one, I wanted to borrow your car and I came to you and I said, yo, you're the worst. Like, you never do nothing for me. It's just like, I can't believe you're such a bad person. Every time I need something, you're never there for me. You never do what I need you to do. You never take care of anything that I need you to take care of. Like, can I just borrow your car for once? Like, can you do this one thing for me? You never are able to do anything for me, but can you do this one thing? Is that too much for you? Or like, you're too busy for that, or you don't have time to do that for me? That's scenario number one, in which I approach you to ask for your car. Scenario number two, I ask you for your car and I say, yo, I appreciate you so much. Like, no, for real. Like, I appreciate you. You're so generous. Like, just in general, you're a generous person. You're a kind person. And the way you just go about life, you truly like inspire me. You inspire me. Like, probably one of the most amazing qualities about you that I've realized is your generosity and how well you treat those that you love. You know, every day I think about how I can give to you, and I hate coming to you and asking you for things because it makes me feel like I don't even deserve to be able to ask you for things when you've given so much to me already. But like, I'm in a situation where I can't really get to work unless today unless I'm able to like drive there because I got to be there extra early. And then my boss told me, you know, really late last night, if I could borrow your car, I'd really appreciate it. I hate even having to ask you for things like this because you already do so much. And I know that's just an extra stress on you. So if you can't, it's all good. But like, could you do that? I would really appreciate that. Right? That's scenario number two that I of me asking to borrow your car. Now, in those two scenarios, which one are you more likely to allow me to borrow your car? Scenario number one or scenario number two? The question hasn't changed. What I was trying to extract from you hasn't changed. All that's changed is my approach. And the reason I give you that example is because I want you to understand how important the approach is, because your approach could be the difference between you getting what you want out of the situation and you not getting what you want out of the situation. So it's like deathly important. The version of you dating men properly is you getting what you want, being able to put aside the jokers and being able to focus your time and attention on the people who are serious. That's your version of dating men properly, because you're getting out of the situation what you want exactly how you want it. Right? So I'm trying to help you to get there. Number three, we have asking questions. Now, this one, I'm going to have to go in detail because I know this is where everyone goes, oh, but what should I say in this? And how should I bring this up? And how should I say this? And what should I do? What time should I bring it up? And what time should I say the sentence? And what's the order I should say the words? Relax. Okay. I'm going to explain it to you. Right. I also want you to listen with your brain, not just your ears, and waiting for me to tell you exactly what to say and how to say it. I want you to extract the concept as well, okay? So that you understand how to deal with it in multiple different scenarios and situations, and you also understand how to come up with even more tailor-made questions, okay? Because asking questions is a very, very, very good way to get to where you want to go, which is extracting the truth out of someone. Obviously, words are just words, right? But enough words will point you in the right direction, right? Or the wrong direction, okay? So you just have to allow people to talk, ask them the right questions, and you can extract the truth. The same way I gave you the example of the police officer and the criminal, you ask enough questions to the criminal, you'll be able to extract the truth of where the murder was and when it happened and at what time and if it was him, right? You just have to ask enough questions in the right way. Okay, so my advice to you would be to, if you're serious about this date, I don't know, for those of you who are not serious about dating or you just wanna have fun or you just wanna have friends with benefits, don't worry about this. If you're serious about the dates or dating or the people that you're trying to go on these dates with and meet up with and spend some time with, I would advise you to have at least 5 ready-made questions that you're going to ask them on the date, okay? Like, and I literally mean like ready-made, like written down in your phone, like put them in your notes, like questions for the date, put them in your notes to ask these guys. Now, it's great for many reasons because I know for some of you, you guys have a lot of social anxiety, okay? And it's kind of nerve-wracking to be on the date and still remember what it was that you wanted to ask someone other than what's your favorite color, what's your background, where were you born? Like, you know, basic stuff. That stuff's not gonna help you get any closer to where you wanna go, okay? Newsflash. That's small talk. That's not gonna help you understand if he's gonna play you. That's not gonna help you understand if he cheated on his last partner. That's not gonna help you understand if he's gonna treat you with love and respect in this relationship. Okay? That's small talk, okay? So you need to have your questions ready so that even if you're nervous on the date, even if he walks in and he's stunning or you get distracted or the food's amazing or the food's trash and your mind goes somewhere else, you still have those questions ready made and you're ready to ask them in the right way so that you know that after you leave the date, you have at least some information, even if it's the first date, you have at least some information that is going to lead you in a direction, right? Because you can't just leave the date being like, oh, I mean, I had a good time, but I don't really know anything about him. That's pointless because you're not moving towards the direction of being able to identify. Remember what I said, we're trying to identify at the very beginning. We're trying to identify, is this the man I'm going to spend the rest of my life with, or is it not? Okay? It's only one of the two. So when you leave the first date, the second date, the third date, you should always be moving closer to that answer every single date. If you're not feeling like you're moving closer to that answer, you're losing, right? You're not doing things properly, right? You're not gathering enough information. Because if you just walk away from the date saying, yeah, I have a bunch of cool memories and nice feelings, but I'm not really any closer to the answer of if this is really someone I should be spending the rest of my life with or not. I just have a bunch of cool and fun memories. You're wasting your own time. Okay, you're wasting your own time. Now, someone said in the chat, examples, please. I knew you guys would want plethora of examples when it comes to questions. And so I'll start off with this. Remember how I said, oh, what's your favorite color and all that stuff is small talk? It is small talk. Now, small talk serves a purpose if you are strategic about it. Okay, but you can also small talk in the right way. That helps you get closer to your goal, which, like I said, is extracting information. Okay. So my advice to you, because I know some of you will say, oh, well, he doesn't really talk. He's such a shy guy. He's super socially awkward too. I can't get him to talk about himself. He never wants to open up. He never wants to this and that. I have a solution for that. Write this down, baby girl. Write this down. Okay. So you start with small talk, something light. Right? So something light, meaning nothing too deep, right? Not yet, not right off the bat. Identify something that he's interested in, okay? Like a hobby, a passion, whatever it may be. Music, maybe he plays the guitar. Singing, dance, I don't know, maybe he's a ballerina, right? Maybe he's a chef, he really loves cooking. Maybe he loves football, basketball, whatever it is that his hobby is or his interest in, you should be able to gather that information fairly quickly throughout the day, okay? Like, you can just, that's super basic beginner questions. What are you interested in? What do you like? What are your hobbies? Things like that, okay? You'll get an understanding of what he's interested in. Even if you're an expert in that, I want you to sit back and pretend like you don't know what that's about. You've never met someone who's been into that world, right? Okay, pretend like you're just completely devious to everything about that world or has to do with that world. Okay, and so when you identify whatever his hobby or thing that he's interested in, then I want you to begin to ask him to teach you more about that topic in particular, whatever it may be. So whether it's he's really into football, okay? Let's say he's really into football and you guys are watching football or he's talking to you about football that he's super interested in and he loves watching and he played in high school, played it in college, whatever. Ask him to teach you about football or help you better understand it. So it could be like, hey, so we're at this restaurant and you're watching the football game up there and there's like a yellow flag thrown on the field. You'd be like, hey, why did they throw that yellow flag? I thought, you know, tackling was legal or whatever in football. And he goes, oh, well, actually, tackling is legal, but you can't grab a face mask. And what he did was he grabbed the face mask of the helmet of the football player. And so when you bring him down with the face mask, it's a penalty because you're risking a lot of injury towards the football player. So it's a natural 15-yard penalty in the sport of football. And you can just continue, oh, okay, interesting. I didn't know that that was the case. Oh, okay, interesting. I didn't know that that was how that worked. And just continue asking him follow-up questions and giving him the opportunity to teach you about whatever it is he's interested in. And the reason this is so great and such a great starter is because he's interested in it, so he's not going to find it boring to talk about, right? And number two, right, he has a lot of knowledge about it. So it's not like he's only going to be able to give you very short answers or not have a real understanding of how it works. So just like the police officer, you don't come out and start trying to have deep conversation when you guys haven't even gotten your first drink on your first date, okay? You ease into it. It's not that you won't ask deep questions. It's not that you won't have a deep conversation. It's that you're going to warm it up. Warm it up, okay? Just have some patience. Know where it is that you're going and you're going to warm it up. because you're going to get there, right? But it's got to be good when you get there. And when you extract the information that you're trying to extract, if a guy loves playing a sport, that's even easier. Because what guy do you know that plays a sport and is really passionate about it that won't sit there and talk to you about his best game or show you his highlights or talk to you about how good he is at the sport? Guys love to brag. You just play into their already existing nature, okay? They think that, oh, I'm making myself look amazing and awesome and like the biggest, best, most amazing, capable man on earth. Meanwhile, you're sitting back like, yeah, sure, keep talking about what you're talking about because I know that I'm making you more comfortable. And as I make you more comfortable, don't worry, we're gonna get to the real questions, okay? So he's getting what he wants because his ego, you see how things work out so well when you play them the right way? He's getting what he wants because his ego's boosted because you're sitting here asking him about how good he was at football or how good he was at basketball or how good he still is. His ego's boosted and you're happy because you're getting him talking and you're also able to gather more and more information out of him. So it's a win-win for everybody. Truly, truly, it's a win-win for everybody, right? So once you get through the small talk, the light stuff that you want to ask him just to get things warmed up, this is when you get into the deeper conversation. This is when you get into the stuff that's juicy, that's really gonna help you understand if this is someone you should be spending the rest of your life with, okay? So you just have to be patient with it. Now, obviously, I'm going to give you guys more examples of more questions because I know you guys want tons and tons of examples and what should I ask and how should I say it. Okay, so listen up, write this down, screen record it if you want, screen record it and go back and listen to it again. Where do you want to be in 5 years? I've talked about that one before. Okay, that one's pretty straightforward. You want to get an idea of if he has direction in his life or not, if he has some sort of goals in mind or not. If he tells you he has no idea where he wants to be in the next 1 year, 5 years, 2 years, 3 years, that tells you he has no direction or goals, in which case you should be walking out, because if he has no direction or goals in his life, he's not going to have any direction or goals in the relationship, in which case you'll be strung along. What experience do you think you learn from the most? This is a great question because people's minds will go wherever they go. If he thinks of a really traumatic situation, he'll tell you about something that might have been really traumatic for him, in which case that's good because you're learning a lot about him. He might tell you about an experience he had that was like out of this world, that was really amazing, or just maybe a situation with a partner or in his life with a family member that was really memorable for him. Either way, it helps you get a deeper understanding of who he is, how he thinks, and what is important to him. These are really good types of questions. Another example of a really good type of question: what's a situation in your life you wish you could do over again? This will get you a really good understanding of what things or experiences he's had that he regrets, okay? Because some people say, oh, I don't have any regrets and da-da-da-da. That doesn't mean that if you could do it again, maybe you would do something differently for a different outcome. And sometimes people will mention something that has to do with their relationship. Sometimes they'll mention something that has to do with the friendship. Sometimes they'll mention something that has to do with a family member. Whatever it may be, it's still good. It's still good because these are the types of questions and answers that will give you a much clearer understanding of what that person is about, what experiences they have, and how they have become the person they are today, right? All of this other stuff about, oh, what's your type? You like tall girls, skinny girls, thick girls? That is not going to do you any good. That's not going to get you any closer to understanding the person. You are trying to learn and understand a human being. If you're asking any types of questions you hear people asking on Love Island, or hear people asking on Too Hot to Handle, or hear people asking on any of these generic dating shows that you see, you know you're very far away from the types of questions you should be asking him. Any of those surface level things that people say generically on dates, you should not be asking. My advice to you, truly, right? Once you get past the small talk, once you've had him teach you about stuff, once you've built a little rapport so that he feels comfortable talking to you, my advice to you would be the only types of questions you should be asking, and this is the concept I want you to take away from this so you know what other types of questions to create, You should only be asking him questions that he would feel uncomfortable answering in front of a crowd or even a group of friends. And if you can't envision that, then flip it onto yourself and say to yourself, if I was being asked this question, would it be uncomfortable for me to answer in front of a crowd or a group of friends? Because that's how you know you're asking an intimate question. And that's a great place to be in. Because when you're asking intimate questions, that's when you really get to learning about the real person. If they're answering you questions that they would answer to their mom or their dad or their brother or their sister or in front of anyone, any stranger, right? First of all, it's a lot easier to lie that way, okay? Because the answer is not close to your heart. It's generic. It's on the surface, right? Second of all, their answer is not really going to give you any insight onto how they uniquely think and feel or what their unique experiences are. Especially when you start asking questions that have to do with someone, things that someone wishes they could take back or experiences that someone wishes they could change or adjust or aren't proud of. Those are always great subjects to touch on because they force someone to be accountable, and being accountable is very painful for a lot of people. Because nobody likes to look in the mirror. Everyone likes to point the finger at someone else. Oh, they did this to me. They did that to me. They said this. They acted like this. It's none of it's my fault, right? When you start asking people questions that force them to be accountable, it's very uncomfortable. A lot of people don't like to have to be accountable in general. Even worse, if they would have to be accountable to a crowd of people and be honest about the wrongdoings that they have committed or the shortcomings that they have committed in their relationships and their friendships and their life, whatever it may be. It's very hard and painful to be that honest with people in general. Okay. And so those are always great places to be when you're asking questions that are actually going to give you some real in-depth knowledge as to the person and how they feel and how they think, okay? You kind of want your questions to be open-ended where it doesn't seem like you're leading them. This is where you have to start thinking like a lawyer, start thinking like a therapist. Like you got to ask almost open-ended questions where you can take it wherever you want to take it. I'm not assuming anything. I'm not, you know, coming to any conclusions about you without me knowing you or understanding you. But the question is insightful, and I do expect to gain some insight, you know, asking the question, right? And you can do it in a way. That's why I started with you guys. When you have the right mindset and you have the right approach, that's when your creativity will come about, because this is a little bit creative, right? Because it's going to take work, right? And you have to be creative in the way you present things. You have to be creative in the way you approach things so that you can extract what you want, right? Also, so that you don't force people to start closing up. Because a lot of you guys come into these dates or these relationships or whatever it may be, talking stages, and you're like already mad. You know what I mean? Like you're already mad. Like, are you going to play me? I don't have time to waste. Are you going to waste my time? What's the longest relationship you've been? You're here to waste my time, aren't you? And it can feel very much like an interrogation, in which case, even if I was here to waste your time, I wouldn't tell you that because you're interrogating me and you're not even making me feel comfortable enough to open up to you. So even if I did cheat on my last ex, why would I tell you? Right? You're not making me feel safe as if this is a place where I can actually share with you or be honest with you, right? And so you lose because your approach is off, right? And you're coming to the situation, tell me everything about you right now. Tell me everything you did wrong. I expect you to tell me all your wrongdoings and all your shortcomings and give me all of the truth. If you're here to play me, just say it right now. I'm going to walk away. That's not really how you get people to tell you the truth. That's not how you extract the truth from people. Saying that or coming to a date or coming into a relationship with that mindset where you better tell me everything about you right now and tell me if you're here to play me is the same way as when I talked about the police officer and the criminal sitting down at the police station. And as soon as the police officer walks in, he asks, did you unalive that guy with a 9mm at 3:45 p.m. on 85th Street? Right? The criminal is going to be like, no. And then what else is there to ask, right? You know what I mean? Because when you're expecting someone to just come out and tell you the truth for the sake of telling you the truth, that's not how life works. You can get the truth, but you're going to have to work for it. You can get the truth. It's going to take some massaging, though. You can get the truth. You just have to be strategic about it. You see how that works? You see how when you paint things with a different lens, right? You can get a very different result. And it can be so much more fun that way when you have a different understanding about it. When you're not going into it, right, with the thinking that, oh, if I like him, then I'm going to give him my Squirtle tonight. Then you're constantly, the only thing you're going to be thinking about on the date is, oh, should I give him the Squirtle tonight or should I not, right? And then you don't end up actually learning anything about the guy or the date because you're so focused on, do I give him the Squirtle tonight or not? Rather than going into the date saying, this is not Squirtle time, I don't care how much I like him, I'm here to learn more about him. So if the night goes, if we have a 2-hour date, if the 2-hour date turns into a 4-hour date, the 4-hour date turns into a 5-hour date, I'm here to learn more about him, not here to give my Squirtle away. So that's off the table, right? But what also happens is your mind can be focused on the right thing. Instead of you getting caught up in the emotion of, oh, I feel good around you. Oh, this is such a nice date. Oh, you're just like the Prince Charming that I read about in my Wattpad story. You're just like the Prince Charming that I read about in my Smut book. And this is like everything that I've ever wanted. So now I'm going to give my Squirtle away to you on the first night. Oops, I gave it away. And now I realize you're actually nothing like the Prince Charming in my Wattpad book or my Smut book or my Wattpad reading or my Smut book. Number four, this is a little bit related to asking questions, but I wanted to bring it its own separate topic. Past relationships. Now we're really in the depths here. This is why I believe it is in your best interest. Because past relationships, right, will also give you insight onto past behaviors. Okay? So if you're trying to identify, because remember, we're trying to identify, is this the man you're going to spend the rest of your life with, or is it not? Those are the only two answers to your equation here. So, past relationships will give you a lot of insight into past behaviors, which will tell you, is this someone that I can spend the rest of my life with, or is this someone I can't spend the rest of my life with based on those behaviors? Okay? Because newsflash to you, for those of you guys who are dating in your 20s and in your 30s, nobody is going to change that drastically between their early 20s or even their late 20s and their 30s, right? Or their 30s and their 40s, right? These are grown adults. Anyone under 20 should not be listening to me. You should be going to study the Pythagorean theorem and reading up on your history books. You don't need to be worried about dating, okay? The rest of you, right? Those are dating grown adults, meaning that they are pretty much who they are going to be. Of course, people grow and change and adjust. I'm not saying that people aren't capable of changing, but the idea that their past relationships will have no effect on their future relationships is idiocy, if you really truly believe that, right? That is a representation of who they've been, where they've been, and the relationships that they've had, right? So when getting an understanding of that will also help you gain an understanding of what to expect, right? And I remember I told you guys, it's very important to have the right mindset. It's very important to have the right approach, right? Because you don't want the past relationships things to feel like an interrogation, okay? I advise you guys, especially when it comes to past relationships, this is why I made this a separate topic from asking questions. I always advise you guys when it comes to past relationships, I want you to present the reason that you're curious about past relationships, because some guys will tell you, oh, why do you care so much about my ex? I don't want to talk about my ex. I don't want this about my ex. I want you to present it as the reason I'm asking about your ex or your past relationships is because I want to make sure I know what didn't work for you in your past relationship so that I don't do that with you, right? And so that our relationship can avoid having those same problems, because I want to make our relationship work, right? When you present it like that, it makes it impossible for him to not share if he's there for the right reasons. Because when you present it as in, I want us to not make the same mistakes as your past relationships, because obviously they didn't work out for a reason. So if I want to avoid having that same reasoning for our relationship not working out, it's better if you tell me everything that happened or didn't work in detail so that I can have an understanding of that and we can come up together with the strategy to avoid that from happening again. You see how that goes from, oh, this is an interrogation to see if you'll cheat on me, to being, oh, no, I want us to work so badly that getting this information will make it even more likely that we'll work out properly. Now, if you say that, and present it that way, and a guy still tells you, well, I don't want to talk about my ex. Oh, I'm not interested in talking about my ex. That is an extreme red flag. That should be an extreme red flag. Okay? Because either he has some sort of love still for his ex that he's trying to hide from you, or he's not even serious about building a long-term serious relationship with you, in which case he doesn't even see the point in talking about his ex relationship, right? Because like I said, if he has the right and the correct mindset and he's here for the right reasons, right, he'll acknowledge that, yeah, that makes sense. If I share with you what didn't work in my past relationship, it'll make it less likely for that to happen now. And of course, I also want our relationship to work out. So of course, I would share with you that information so that our relationship could work out. You see how it all feeds into each other, right? If he has the right mindset, then this will work in a particular direction. If he doesn't have the right mindset, then it won't work. That approach won't work. But you know that that approach is not working because he has other things on his mind, whether he wants to use you for your Squirtle or whether he might have some leftover love and adoration for his ex, in which case that is not going to work for you. Either way, that's not going to work for you, right? So when you approach it like that, you basically corner him or back him into a corner where the only option is for him to tell you. Otherwise, he lets it be known that he's not here for the right reasons. So I always advise you, when it comes to past relationships, make sure to go into detail about the most recent ex, especially because obviously that's the last one. Go into detail about that and get some also ancillary, you know, other information about other past relationships, in order to understand common themes, right? And likely personality traits or issues to expect. The reason why, obviously, you want to ask about the most recent ex, that's pretty straightforward. You also want to get, you know, at least a general understanding of what went on in his other relationships, even if they were young relationships, even if they're a little bit earlier, whatever it may be, right? Because it helps give you an understanding if he has had multiple girlfriends, you know, and ex-girlfriends. It helps you gain an understanding of what themes have been consistent in all of his relationships. So what do I mean by that? For example, if you ask a guy, okay, why did you and your most recent ex break up? And he says, oh, well, distance. And then you ask him, okay, your girlfriend before that, why did you and her break up? Oh, well, distance. And then, okay, your girlfriend in high school, you dated for a year. Why did you guys break up? Oh, I went to college, so distance. Right? It becomes very clear, right, what the reoccurring issues are. And now you can explore those issues and say, okay, so clearly distance doesn't work for you. Why do you think distance doesn't work for you? Why do you think, you know, distance played a role in, you know, kind of, you know, ruining all of those relationships? How did they fall apart? You also know in the back, you don't have to say this, but you also know in the back of your mind, right, that if this relationship is going to work in any capacity, there definitely can't be too much distance. Okay? So you need to be clear and have your own clarity on, are we even going to be in a relationship where there's no distance ever? Because if we are going to be in a relationship where there's distance, I probably should reconsider if this is the relationship for me. Right? Because he's telling me how all his relationships didn't work out simply because of distance. And I know that I live 4 hours away, or I know that I live, you know, in another country. Is this relationship supposed to be different? Right? If the distance is outside of your control, you got some decisions to make. Because how are you supposed to expect that this relationship will be drastically different than all the other exes who ended up the same way and it was because of distance? And when you're asking them questions or even asking them about their past relationship, you don't want to structure the question in a way that would even make them or push them in the direction of being defensive of their own character, right? You want to make it seem like, oh, I understand that the reason your relationship didn't work out is because of a combination of things that, you know, the team didn't work. So tell me about the team and why the team didn't work out. That makes people a lot more comfortable answering your question, right? From a perspective of, oh, I did some things, she did some things, I said some things, she said some things, and then you just want to be paying very close attention, right? Pay more attention to what he says he did, right? because what they say someone else did is, you know, people love to blame others, right? But it's pay very close attention to what they say they did and extract that. I have a couple of examples here about past relationship questions because I know you guys want specific examples. No, tell me what to say. How should I say it? I want to write it down. I want to say it the next time. I want to write it down. Okay, I got you. Okay, so for example, what's the biggest issue you and your ex struggled with? Okay, that's a good one. What's the biggest issue you and your ex struggled with? What wasn't working for you in your last relationship and that you don't want for the future? Right? You see how that one's structured? What wasn't working for you? So yeah, blame someone else. Blame whatever you want. Blame the circumstances, blame the situation, blame the distance. But what wasn't working for you? People are good at thinking what wasn't working for me. When you start asking them what someone else was thinking or how what they did to that person, what wasn't working for you? They should have clarity and a crystal clear understanding of what wasn't working for them. If they say things like, oh, I don't know what wasn't working for me. Now you know you're with someone that is either hiding their past relationship from you for a reason because they have feelings for them, or they're just here to play you, in which case they have no desire to discuss to you past relationships. You understand? Because there should be no reason why a guy can't answer what wasn't working for themselves in their last relationship, okay? And then another good one is, if you could go back, what actions would you change in your last relationship, right? Obviously, this one is more centered towards regret, right? And actions, right, is not an assumption that you did anything bad, but if you could go back and change some actions, what would you change, right? So like I say, it's not an assumption that you did something bad. It's not an assumption that you know you're a bad person or, you know, there's anything egregious that you did. But if you could, maybe you had the opportunity, what would you change? And this is the crazy part. Everyone in this dating culture is used to people not caring. Everyone's on their phone. You know, you go out on the date, people are texting, they're getting messages, they're getting calls, they got work. Nobody's really paying attention to everything. Nobody's attention is fully on anything. So what happens is you think, oh, me writing down questions and, like, you know, presenting to him these questions, that's super unattractive. He's not going to be seduced by that. But what's actually happening is when you come to the date prepared with questions, they think to themselves, oh my goodness, first of all, this is a prepared woman. This is not a woman I should be messing around with, which is good because you're getting his wheels spinning that I can't mess around with her. She actually knows what she wants. She actually knows, you know, can go for what she wants. She actually, like, can take control of a situation. Oh, I have to be a man here. I can't just mess around with her, right? That already gets his mind spinning in that direction. But what it also does, right, is it makes him feel special. Okay, because you actually were able to put your phone down and pay attention to what you wanted to learn more about him to the extent that you wrote down questions and prepared them for this date. Okay, it's flattering that someone would care enough about you, especially for a first date or even a second date or third date, whatever. It's flattering as a human being, not just a girl, as a human being, that someone would care enough and pay attention to you enough that they would prepare questions for you, specifically for you, for this date to better get to know you, right? It shows that you care enough, right, that you want to make sure you're learning everything that you wanted to learn and that you were even thinking about this date leading up to this date. It's flattering, right? Think about it from your own perspective. If a guy came to you and was on a date with you, and he said, oh, you know, I actually have a list of questions that I wrote down for you like a night before, and I wanted to make sure I got the chance to ask them for you. Would that make you feel good, or would that make you be like, oh, this is super unattractive? Do you understand what I'm saying? Even if it's like, oh my God, like, that's a lot, or oh my God, that's scary, or oh my God, is he going to use that against me? There still has to be the acknowledgement, and we would all acknowledge that the only type of person that would do that is someone that cares. The only type of person that would do that is someone that is serious. The only type of person that would do that is someone that is here for the right reasons. And so if you're on a date, right, all of that is good and positive signaling, Okay. The world, this is where I'm going to get philosophical, and you guys know I go on a couple rants every now and again. Okay. The world has tried to convince you that not caring is cool. Okay. Swipe left, swipe right on everyone. Don't really have any real conversation with anyone. Meet up on the date. Don't really care about them. Don't really remember anything about them. Don't really talk about anything serious or real or deep. Just have a bunch of small talk. Jump right into SEX. You know what I mean? Even though you don't know the person, and just hope something good happens from there. Yeah, that's how the world should be. Don't go deep on anything. Don't actually care about anything. Scroll through your phone. Be docile, just consume, don't even try to understand, nothing's that deep, everything's surface level, don't create any deep, long-lasting relationships or connections, none of that. Right? That's what the world has tried to convince you, right? And that's what the world has tried to convince you, that's how you should be living your life. It's not that deep. Everything on the surface. If a guy comes to, you know, if me writing questions for a date, that's too much. Why would I? That'd be weird. You know, that's giving it to an interview, right? The world has made it lame to take dating and relationships seriously. Okay? Because the world wants you to care about nothing and just sit on your couch and have life happen to you. But what happens is when you don't take the dating or the relationship seriously, and then you sit around and you wonder, hey, why are none of my relationships serious? That's why. You don't take any of your relationships seriously. And so none of your relationships are serious. You got a bunch of friends with benefits and you got a roster of people who only care about using you for mutual master slation. You know what I mean? So number 5, set clear boundaries. Now, I know this is a place that a lot of you struggle with. You have to be crystal clear about your expectations and your standards from a man that will have romantic access to you, and you have to allow him to decide if he wants to and can be that for you. Okay? You do not ask this of him, right? Meaning you do not ask him to be the person that you need him to be or you need in a relationship. You make it clear what you expect in a relationship from a man that is going to be your romantic partner, and you leave it up to him to decide if he wants to be that or if he cannot be that. Okay? Let him make a choice. He has to respect you. Okay? Right? And there has to be a little bit of fear in his heart that if he doesn't respect you, he will not get access to you. Okay? Remember how I told you guys on Friday, I don't know if you guys heard, or if you guys were part of the live stream there at the end on the Friday, we did a little Q&A, and I told you guys I'm like a drill sergeant. That's why, like, one of the reasons, that's like one of my red flags. I'm like a drill sergeant, so I like to have things my way, but I make it very clear what I expect. But if you're not gonna abide by that, that's fine. You're done though. Okay? But like, I'm a drill sergeant, so I take it to the extreme. But I say that to say, right, it's very important that the people you're dating or you're seeing or you're in a relationship with, they should have a little bit of fear. Okay? I know when I say fear, you guys think, oh, that's abusive. That's wrong. Why should he be in fear? Your partner should have a little bit of fear. Not so much, but a little bit of fear that if they don't act right or don't do the right thing, they don't say the right thing, that you might leave them. That's healthy fear. Because that healthy fear will force them to make good decisions. Okay? They will be in fear that if they don't make good decisions, they will not have you anymore. That's good. You want people in the mindset that I do not want to lose her, so I must make the right decision. It's a good motivation. Think about this logic. The guys who you consider loyal to their girlfriend, like they would never cheat on their girlfriend in a million years, where do you think that truly stems from? Yes, respect. But they're not just loyal for the sake of being loyal. They're loyal for the fear of losing their girl. In the event that their girl was like, oh, I would stay with you no matter what. Even if you cheat on me, I'll stay with you, right? Do you think they would still be loyal for the sake of being loyal? No. It stems from the respect, which stems from the fear of losing that girl. And they want to keep that girl, specifically that one. Which is why they don't, right, act upon whatever they feel. They don't just say whatever they want to say. They don't just go wherever they want to go, right? They abide by the rules and the expectations and the standards and the boundaries. Because there is fear that if they don't abide by those set of rules, they will not have access to that woman. Very simple. Okay? So it is actually a good thing if your man or the guy that you're seeing or you're dating has a little bit of fear that if he doesn't act right, you will walk away. That is good. That is healthy. It means he has respect for you. The guys that have absolutely no fear that you will walk away if they don't act right or treat you right are the guys who will treat you like trash. Which is, I'm sure, where most of you have been. The guys that have no fear of you or whether or not you're going to walk away, they treat you like trash because why would they treat you with respect? It doesn't matter, right? Why would they put in effort in the relationship? It doesn't matter. Why would they be consistent? It doesn't matter. They still get what they want from you. They don't lose access to you. Why would they have any fear of losing you? They don't lose you. You will only get the respect that you demand. I know when I'm saying this to you, I'm a man, obviously, and you're a woman. So you're thinking, oh my God, I have to go around demanding respect. Yes. You only, in this world that we live in, you only get the respect that you demand. Nobody's going to give you respect for no reason. Nobody's going to give you respect for your mere existence. You have to demand respect from people. And when they see that you're serious about that respect and you stand on it, they will respect you. You might rub some people the wrong way at first. They might be like, oh, you're a party pooper. Why are you so serious? Why can't you just let loose? And then eventually they respect you for it. Trust me. When people realize that you're not on the BS, you're not about the BS and you stand on that, they might try to be like, oh, well, you know, she's a B word. You know, why she's so extra, y'all. She doing the most. Da, 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 da. But at the end of the day, you stood on what you stood on and they can't argue with that. And eventually, as they mature or even after a while, they come back around and they realize, you know what? I respect what you did. And I understand why you did it. Negative feelings towards you for having respect for yourself and for setting those boundaries turns into admiration for the fact that you were able to set boundaries and demand that respect. And then what happens? They come back and they respect you. That's why it's so important to start this at the very beginning, because when you establish this, right, it's very easy to continue this. It's a lot harder, I'm going to be honest with you, it's a lot harder to reverse this when you've already established the fact that you don't stand on your boundaries, you don't respect yourself enough to actually walk away from a situation or set boundaries, okay? It's a lot harder to switch because the person is so used to you allowing you to disrespect them that when you stand up and you start saying, I want to be respected around here, they just laugh at you because they're like, you never in your life have you ever, spoke up for yourself. So this is a joke, right? And then they just continue to disrespect you. Okay. That's why it's very important to set the precedent from the very beginning that you demand respect. And that's the only way this relationship's going to exist. And like I said, you don't ask him for that. You tell him the only type of man who will have access to me is a man who respects me. In the event a man disrespects me, he will not have access to me. Simple, simple, simple. You don't have to make it an attack of his character. You don't have to make it, oh, I beg you and I plead you to act like this, or I beg you and I plead you to treat me like this. It's very simple. There's only one circumstance under which a man will have access to me. It is either this or it's nothing. Very simple, right? And like I say, some of you guys are probably thinking, oh, but that's not seductive, or that's not going to make him rock solid, or that's not going to allow him to be into me. No, no, no. Actually, he'll be very into the fact that you respect yourself, have standards, and expectations and abide by those standards and expectations, because he's going to realize if I want to be with her, I have to raise the bar. Okay. I have to raise my own standards. And do you remember what I said to you guys in the past live stream about the live stream was titled How to Make Yourself Irresistible to Men? I talked about one of the main things I talked about, all right? The signs that a guy's really into you. Sorry, that was the title of the live stream. I talked about when he's really into you, it's going to be because you make him a better man and you inspire him and motivate him to be a better man. So when you come into the relationship and you say, look, these are my standards, these are my expectations. If they're too high for you, I don't give a shit, because those are my standards and expectations. If that doesn't work for you, that doesn't work for you. Those are the only men that are going to have access to me, though. He says to himself, oh my God, I have to actually be a better man if I want access to this woman. So what does he do when he wants to become a better man? Now, the guys that have no motivation to be a better man and they don't want to do anything with their lives, those men will probably not be attracted to or turned on by the fact that you actually force him to be a better man, in which case that's a win for you. You don't want the unmotivated couch slobs that aren't going to do anything with their lives and have no motivation to grow or get better. That's not going to be a man for you. Okay. You only want to be attracting the men who are motivated to grow and get better and improve in their life, in their relationships, and everything. Okay? And that's the type of man you'll attract when you have standards and respect and expectations. Do you think the guy that you're begging for his attention, do you think if he got access to go on a date with Kim Kardashian or to go on a date with his favorite IG model, go on a date with Megan Good, go on a date with who's another, Iggy Azalea, go on a date with, I don't know who, okay? You think if he got a chance to go on a date with any of the IG models that he'd be liking all their pictures, you think he wouldn't wear his best fit, get a haircut? You think he wouldn't pay for the date, be respectful, be kind, open doors? Why? Right? Because he knows internally, this is a woman I should respect. She can get any man that she wants. She's not going to settle for me if I don't treat her with respect and show her the best of the best. So what do? They stand up straight, right? They get it together and they present the absolute best version of themselves that they possibly can. It's not about him being a different guy. It's about the amount of respect he has for that woman that he wants to make sure he puts his best foot forward. That's why I always tell you guys, it's not about looks, because you can make a man feel like that and you can trigger that in him without looking like Kim Kardashian. Newsflash to you. You don't have to look like Kim Kardashian to make guys respect you. Truthfully. That's actually a good news for you. Good news for all of us. Okay? You don't have to look like a supermodel to get guys to respect you. Okay? But you do have to change your approach, right? And you do have to set clear boundaries and abide by those boundaries. And you actually have to mean that. Like, you can't be... This is why I always tell you guys, the first answer to your question, you got to start investing into yourself, gain that confidence, gain your own internal validation that you're not seeking it from other people, that you're not in fear that, oh my God, if you don't like me, then it's the end of my world. If you don't like me and don't want to be with me, then I have no one else in this world that will want to be with me. Because when you have that fear, you won't be able to actually set boundaries. Even when you do set boundaries, there'll be fake boundaries, right? Because the boundaries that you do set won't be real. You're just hoping that please don't cross that boundary. But if you do, I'll still be with you. What's the point? He won't respect you anyways. Along the way, you have to make sure that when he does something small that irritates you or crosses a boundary, that you punish him. Yes, I said punish him. And when it is addressed, you make sure that the issue, what it was for you, whatever the issue was for you, is very clear. For example, if you say, I do not want to be in a relationship with a man who is going to, solve problems or fights by yelling at me and calling me out of my name. I'm not going to deal with that. I'm not going to, that's not something that I'm going to ever tolerate, a man that calls me outside of my name when we're in a fight or an argument. We can argue, we can have issues, we can have disagreements. There's no need for me. I don't do that. And there's no need for my man to be doing that. Let's say you make that very clear. And then while you guys are in some sort of heated argument a couple weeks or a couple months later, he calls you the B word in a fight. Instead of you saying, oh, please don't call me the B word. Why would you do that? I don't like that. I told you that I don't like that. No. You grab your stuff. You pack it up. You don't say a word. And you walk out the door. And when he texts you and he calls you in a couple hours, right? You don't answer his texts. You don't answer his calls. He's lost you, right? At least he believes he's lost you. I'm talking about this happens at the beginning, right? He believes he's lost you. Oh my gosh, I messed up. He's going to call you. I apologize. Yo, I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have did this. You shouldn't have done that. You let him wallow in it for a day. Let him soak it in for a day. Okay. This is why I say it's so important to have your own validation so that you're not in fear that you're going to lose him. Okay. You let him soak it in for a day. He's not going to disappear or forget about you in a day. You let him soak it in. He's going to acknowledge what he did wrong, right? A day later, you come back. You say, look, I already told you that I don't appreciate the disrespect in an argument. I don't care how upset you were. You don't call me outside of my name. That's not something I'm going to tolerate. When he's had time to soak it in and acknowledge his own wrongdoing, what's going to happen is he's going to realize, oh, she's not playing. Oh, I'm sorry. I wasn't familiar with your game. I apologize, right? There's going to be a very sobering effect, right? When he gets in a small dose, this is why I say you do this at the very beginning, right? Because these are going to happen in the process of you dating someone, right? That things are going to happen and, you know, they're going to cross smaller boundaries. Not every boundary is going to be he cheats on you, okay? Smaller boundaries that you have. There has to be some sort of consequence or punishment. Obviously, it doesn't have to be that extreme, like I just said. But there has to be some sort of consequence or punishment that he can identify. Okay, when she says she does not like something, or when she says she does not want something to happen, or doesn't appreciate when something is said or happens, she actually means it. And there's actual consequences for me acting a particular way, right? And they realize going on in the future, I can't, if she says, don't do this, I actually should not do that. It's not a free for all where I get to act however I want, say whatever I want and expect there to be no consequences. Okay. And he gets that mindset in the very beginning where he knows you're not someone to play with. And he has that fear that, she don't play that. You want the guys, listen to me, trust me, listen to me. This is a guy telling you this. Like, this is someone who has played girls myself. You want your guy, your man, you want him to talk about you when he's talking about you to other people. You want him to be saying things like, my girl don't play that. Nah, she don't play that. Nah, my girl, she don't play like that. I can't do that. She don't play like that. When you have your man in that position, that is the perfect position for you to be in. It doesn't make you a party pooper. It doesn't make you a boring girl because you don't play that, or because, you know, he knows he can't mess around with you, right? It makes you a wife. Okay? Newsflash. It makes you a wife. It makes you a wife because that means he has respect for you. And that means he has fear that if he doesn't act right, there will be consequences. The fun girls, the say yes to everything girls, he will never say, she don't play that. They will never say that about those girls. Yeah, sure, those fun girls might get attention. Those fun girls don't get any respect, though. Those fun girls also don't get a ring. Sorry to tell you. Fun girls don't get married. Fun girls don't become wives. Fun girls are fun forever. But they're only just fun. There comes a point in your life, though, where you need things more than just fun. If you want to be a fun girl that says yes to everything, you can be, but don't expect anyone to commit themselves to you. Number six, observe actions. A lot of you guys go about this different ways, and I want to make it clear to you how you should go about this the best way for you in your dating life. Allow him to show you what he is about. Do not beg him to be what you need. It's like I said before, you're not asking him to be that person. Don't beg him to be what you need. Identify what you need ahead of time, i.e. writing down your wish list like I talked about. Your wish list is just, what do you want? I wish for a man who will be rich, whatever. I want, but be specific about your wishes. I wish that we live in a mansion in Colorado Springs. I wish that we live in Miami. I don't know why you'd want to live in Miami with your partner, but I wish that we live in Miami. Okay. I wish that we have a 3,000 square foot. You want to be very clear about what you want out of a relationship to yourself, so that when you're observing these actions, you can identify whether he is in line with that or not. So, for example, if you need a gentleman in your relationship because you hate screaming and yelling and fighting and shouting, maybe your parents screamed and yelled and fought and shouted with each other, and that was just something that you know you don't want in your relationship because you know you don't like it and you don't appreciate it. Let's say, for example, right? You do not beg him to treat you that particular way. You let it be known what you expect. You let it be known the type of relationship that you want. If he shows you other than that, so let's say he curses you out all the time, he's punching walls, he's pushing you against walls, you know, he's doing all this crazy stuff to you, and he shows you that, don't then sit back and be trying to, oh, well, I guess, you know, he'll change his behavior. Oh, well, I guess, you know, I got to give him a chance to this and that. No. You observe the actions for what they are. You don't justify his actions. You don't try to explain away his actions. You observe them for what they are. This is where I say it's hard for a lot of us, because we have to remove our bias, especially when we start liking someone, of, oh, I love you so much, so I'm going to see your action as justified because I love you so much. It's a lot easier said than done. I know, trust me, I've been there, okay? But at least when we discuss it, it'll be on your mind that you'll at least be able to maybe step out of your body and be like, hey, I understand I have a bias against you because I really like you. I need to take some time to realize, okay, am I seeing this for what it is? Or am I just seeing this for what I want it to be? Because I want you to be a good person. I want you to, you know, us to be in a relationship. I want this to work out. Once you've done all the other things, you need to observe actions and be honest with yourself about those actions. You don't justify those actions, right? You don't make excuses for them, and you don't let them make excuses for them. Okay? You take things on the surface for what they are, because that's the only thing. Remember what I said at the very beginning. The whole purpose of this is for you to decide one of two possibilities. Is this the man you're going to spend the rest of your life with, or is it not the man you're going to spend the rest of your life with? Those are the only two possible outcomes of this situation. And everything you're trying to do leading up until this point is to assess that. Okay? And understand that there's only two possibilities. And so in observing his actions, you need to be honest with yourself. Is this moving towards he is the person I'm going to spend the rest of my life with, because he could be showing you a bunch of good things? Or is it moving towards, this is not the person I'm going to spend the rest of my life with because he's showing you a bunch of bad things? It's going to be one of the two. But you need to remember why you're there, and remember the information you're trying to extract and what result you're trying to get. And number seven, we have reassess progress. To your wish list, remember I talked to you guys about your wish list, the things that you want in the relationship, in your life in general, but also specifically in your relationship, be very specific in your wish list about what you want, right? And identify if the relationship is moving in the direction you want or not. Remember, it is only one of the two. So you have to be reassessing as time goes on in the relationship. Is this moving in the direction I want it to move, which is getting closer to us being in a long-term serious relationship and this being the man I'm going to spend the rest of my life with? Or is it not moving in that direction, which means it's moving towards he is not the person I'm going to spend the rest of my life with? Okay? You have to reassess that consistently, periodically, right? And be honest with yourself. It goes along with observing action. And be honest with yourself if which one is the case. Once you identify which one is the case, this is the most important part. Obviously, it's a learning process, right? You might go on with someone for a year and then realize that, no, this is not it. But I'm saying once you if you get to the point where you realize, yeah, this is not in line with the relationship that I want. This isn't going in the direction that I want it to go. I've reassessed this, and for multiple reasons, this isn't the type of relationship I want for the rest of my life. You then must make a choice. Did you hear what I said? Did you hear what I said? Turn the volume up on your phone. You then must make a choice. Make a choice. Do not stay when you once you've identified that someone is not working for you and is not the person that you want to spend the rest of your life with, and it's not the relationship that you want to be in. Do not stay and stick around and then blame others for wasting your time, because you are wasting your own time. Okay? You are wasting your own time. Don't sit around, right? When someone has shown you who they are through their words, their actions, your experience with them, all that good stuff that we talked about, right? Do not sit around after having identified all of that and having made the conclusion that this is not the relationship for you. Don't sit around, right, and stay in the relationship because you don't want to make a choice, and then wonder why the relationship is not working, and then blame other people when he cheats on you, or blame other people when, you know, you realize he's got another girlfriend or something like that, for wasting your time. Because once you've identified that this isn't what you want, everything after that is a waste of your own time. And that is a choice that you have made. That is a choice that you have made. If you choose to stay after you identify this isn't the relationship that you want, you are choosing to stay. And after that, there is nobody else to blame for any wrongdoings that happened to you except for you. I know we don't like taking accountability. I know we all like to sit here and be like, oh, no, but it's them. No, but it's my ex. No, but it was this person. And no, this person was a horrible person. No, he was a narcissist. No, he was this. No, he was that. You give people an opportunity to show you who they are. If they show you that they are not who you need them to be in a relationship, you make a choice to leave that relationship. If you can't make that choice, it's too scary for you. You don't have the guts to do it. Fine. Don't turn around in a year and complain to everyone how they treated you badly for so long. Because that was a choice you made to stay in that relationship. I truly mean that. I don't want to burst your bubble. I don't want to make you feel bad. But it's the truth. That goes for not just your relationships, that goes for your friendships, that goes for everything, okay? You are accountable to the investment into the wrong people. Did you hear what I said? You are accountable into the investment you put in to the wrong people. Don't complain about how bad someone's treating you and then sit around and continue letting them mistreat you. It becomes your obligation to remove yourself from the situation. Don't sit around telling me how you can't remove yourself from the situation and then continue complaining how bad the situation is. Either suck it up and deal with it and get treated badly, or leave. Don't complain and don't leave. Because I've noticed that that's what a lot of you are doing. It's not just girls, but I've noticed that that's what a lot of you are doing. You're staying and complaining. Either leave or shut up. One of the two. If it's not enough for you to leave, you know, if the situation isn't bad enough for you to leave, shut your mouth and deal with it. If that's what you want. If it's too much, it's too unbearable, then leave. Right? A lot of you guys have questions, even for me, that are basically along those same lines. Oh, he's doing this, he's doing that. What should I do? How should I respond? This and that. And most of the time, it's a simple choice that you make where it's like, okay, he's done that to you. You know exactly what he did. You know exactly why he did it. You know exactly what he said. You know exactly why he said it. You know exactly how it made you feel. Okay, so make a choice. Is that too much for you to continue being in a relationship with him? If it's too much and you know that's not going to work for you, leave. if you want me to sit around and, oh, that's so sad. Your life is so sad. It's so tragic what you went through. We should write a book about your sad, sad life. Let me play you a song on the world's saddest and smallest violin. Wee woo, wee woo. You guys know that from SpongeBob? Wee woo, on the world's smallest violin. Wee woo, wee woo. Get real. Either walk away or suck it up and shut up. If you know you're not going to leave, suck it up and shut up, right? And deal with it. Or walk away if it doesn't work for you. Now, I know not all situations are that simple, but most of them are, okay? If it works for you, then it works for you, stay. If it doesn't work for you and it doesn't work for you, walk away. You guys want so much advice from other people to tell you how to live your life and what you should do, how you should live this, how you should do that, what you should eat in the morning. If it works for you, stay, keep it, do it. If it doesn't work for you, change it, leave it, adjust it,